well.
Thank you again, and forgive me if I say something silly. I'm still half asleep. I'm 13 hours away from my normal hours for sleep. And I don't know if I'm dreaming or this is really true. But I don't know if this is going to be what you expect, because I was told that it was only to speak for 15 minutes and that not necessarily had to do with showing the words I do. So I'm just going to start with this name, Juan Snake. And I like the quote of Nikola Tesla when he said that out of the deepest darkness, light is born. I really like that because he also said something Mr. Einstein is a very good guy, but he's actually wrong. Two parallel lines meet at the end. And after so much thinking about it, well, as an artist, I came up with this. For those who have been to Mexico, you may have seen and been to Teotihuacan, a city that is presumably built some say 200 AD, apparently 200 BC, and it disappeared as a culture in 900 BC, approximately. There is this fantastic building there that has supposedly these heads that are called Quetzalcoatl, and I've always wondered what the meaning of snakes over and over from pre-Hispanic days, as far as 2,000 years earlier or even earlier than that, what they represent. This fascination has turned into a research I've been conducting, and here I want to present Guatlicue. As you can see, it's a sculpture in stone. It's about 2 meters high, and it's probably about a ton or 2 tons in weight. It's quite massive. People like Octavio Paz, a renowned Mexican writer, said that it was a monstrous thing that the pre-Hispanic people had come up with, and that it obviously breaks the other canon of Western art. But I think he was wrong, because it actually represents, in my opinion, something far more interesting. For those who are not acquainted with this image, you can see here that this is it's pretty much like a human being, the arms, the chest, the head, and the 2 legs. In actual fact, these are 2 snakes that are meeting each other, and then this that represent the arms is actually 2 snakes that are being cut off, and what we see here is actually the blood that is dropping from it. Guatlicue means one who dresses in whose dress is made of skirts, but this is what archaeologists say. I don't agree with them. I think it represents something far more interesting, and I'm coupling it with this image of as you can see, it's a deceased person, and it's being swallowed up also by a snake. And this is interesting to me because the snake represents both death and life. And through my study of it, I came across with the Florentine Codex, a codex that was written in italics characters. And what fascinated me was that I've been reading the Florentine Codex that was written about 40 years after the conquest, that means 1560 in Mexico, and it was written by Fray Bernardino de Sahagún, a friar from Spain. And what we all know in Mexico is that this particular person was very knowledgeable in many languages, and I have come to respect him pretty much, because when he writes, I can sense that he wants to write the exact sound of Nahuatl words, and in a very, let's say, very accurate in writing this, and so enchanted with the web life of pre-Hispanic times that he wanted to prove to the Spanish crown that they were not conquering a savage country. But when it comes to speaking with the then wise people, the Tlamacasqui, straight away told him, it is not true that we have to die in order to go to heaven or hell. We have already been summoned, we've already been brought into this paradise if we can only live in harmony with him. This, of course, was contradicting the Christian tradition, and especially when it comes to a point when describing what snakes meant for the vanquished people, immediately goes into a wonder in what he's writing. He's not actually translating, he's actually making commentaries that allude to the devil, to the sort of iconography that Christianity has built around the serpent in centuries. But what you are actually looking here is this mat made of snakes. And you can see this circle here, because the Aztec people, pardon me, the Tula people that were talking to him, trying to explain that when a person sits in the mat of snakes, quickly realizes that he's just an illusion, that his body is not really existent. And what I'm trying to point out here is that they were explaining to him something that he simply did not have the tools to understand. What I'm trying to explain with this is that a snake was used as an iconography to represent the synodal waves of a phenomena. But more interestingly, when we are coming back to this image, because what he was explaining is that when a person realizes his true essence, in today's terms, our the atoms of our skin, our bodies are not that different, and in fact we are immersed in a quantum sea of subatomic particles. In other words, he was confronting a civilization that had already, in my opinion, had arrived to the concept of quantum mechanics that today Western culture that has permeated the world is only had pretty much like nearly 200 years. And so this conception is totally out of his, it was out of his understanding. But to me, it means more than that, because it also explains why indigenous people have such a resilience. Then I found other concepts like the Tsitsimimit, which as you can see, I interpreted to be the radiation falling from the cosmos into the earth. Curiously, for those who have been to Mexico, may have been to a place called Chichen Itza in the south, southern peninsula of Yucatan. There is this interesting pyramid that has four sides, each of them 90 steps, and with a platform at the top, they complete 365 days. It's a calendar. And from these staircases, there is a 9 bodies of the structure that cast on the side of the, if these were the bodies, they cast a shadow on that side. And as the sun goes down, the snake that is made of the shadow slithers down into the underground. At the bottom of the pyramid, there is a massive stone carving on the head of the snake. And people have interpreted in very different ways. The way I interpreted with other people is that the pyramid actually was an alarm clock that was meant to ring around our time. If you remember, in 2013, there was like this worldwide idea that the Mayans had predicted that the world was coming to an end, and the various films and stories were created around it, mostly by Hollywood. But we believe them, or who do we believe? In my opinion, what they, he was, they were talking to him is that, and I think it's scientifically is acknowledged this way, that, that the center of the galaxy aligns with the sun and the Earth at such a point that is the farthest distance from the center of the galaxy. In other words, it's coming back again because the solar system is spinning around the center of the galaxy almost in like the planets spin around the sun, meaning that they are not concentric. In other words, when we know that when we are in winter, it's because we are the farthest point, also with the creation of the planet, and therefore we experience the cold weather. And we name these different aspects as winter, spring, and so on. For prehistoric times, because of the latitude of Mexico, there is only the acknowledgement of two seasons, wet or dry. It's not like in European terms. But putting that aside, the idea is that the entire solar system is moving on. It takes 2,570 years to spin, to complete a spin around the center of the galaxy. And for 5,000 years, we are going to experience that we are moving closer and closer to the center of the galaxy. And in the very same way that the sun affects the Earth in springtime, that becomes the Earth becomes pregnant, the entire solar system is going through what I call a cosmic spring of 5,000 years, approximately. To me, that's important because not only to attest that the pre-Hispanic people were no savage, that actually was a very important civilization, but also, more interestingly for our days, is the idea that through biocentrism that has become a very popular idea of how the universe function, is to do with the abandonment, in a way, of classical physics that they state that it's only matter and energy that can transmit into each other, but not we cannot create them or destroy them. Today, biologists especially are saying that it's not just matter and energy, but also the mind. And the mind, therefore, is in quantum mechanics affecting the way we perceive things, not just through our senses, but also because the mind actually affects the positioning of subatomic particles. The reason I find this important is because I feel that in terms of ecological destruction, we must take responsibility of our acts, and therefore, pretty much in the Buddhist idea that exists in this part of the world, we are responsible for our thoughts, our words, and our actions. And therefore, or rather because of that, native societies drew their legal jurisdiction in terms of responsibility in such a way that they stated that, and it is a thought that is still around in indigenous people in Mexico, that freedom that Western values have promoted so important, and individuality are actually not a real, not a reality, because we depend on the air to breathe, and we depend on the soil to feed, and therefore there is only interdependence, and it follows on that for that reason we are responsible for our actions. In ecological terms, I feel it's a very important situation to acknowledge because evidently through very many different mechanics in the way we exist, we are not doing that, and we are pushing the world into a destructive situation. I work with electronics and mechanical contraptions in order to make things gesticulate situations. This is because when you speak Nahuatl, through Nahuatl, you have to acknowledge that everything in life, whether it's a car, an airplane, a house, or a person, or an animal are indeed people, meaning persons. I find this idea beautiful because if I can regard the house as a person, I can construct a friendship with the house. If I regard a human being not as a person, of course this is what happens all over the place. They are just simply objects that people used and abused. There is also, I know that it's very little time to explain all this, and so I'm making it very short, but here we are seeing the chuck mold, which is a reclined shape, and if you can appreciate it, it sort of follows the sign other way, with the feet and the legs. The position, I think, is very uncomfortable for anyone who wants to sit that way, so it's not a natural representation of a person, it's something else going on. And in this particular sculpture, you can see that it has like a table. In this case, the hands are supported here. It was because what they were representing is the traveling of Quetzalcoatl. Because in prehispanic times, Quetzalcoatl is, as I said, not just an image that represented, that represents, in fact, very many different things. Quetzalcoatl is associated with the Milky Way, with the appearance of Venus. And Venus was particularly important because it has six periods, four of which are actually when the planet is actually not seen. And from then it developed a cosmogony that is, I think, interesting because the human soul was to be understood not to, or rather, the sun was not understood just as a burning object in the sky, but it's also the giver of souls, not just to people, but to every living aspect in the world. And so the planet Venus, when it appears in the morning, is called Quetzalcoatl, and when it appears in the evening, it's called Xolotl. Xolotl is a dog that guides Quetzalcoatl into the underground to where he is to bring the bones of the elements to create the bones of people. And he travels into the underworld. If you go to Mexico, you visit Tula, which is an ancient city as well. And there are all these marking spots that the archaeologists have been able to pinpoint. So you can see that there are places where he's supposedly going into the underworld. And when he travels into the underworld, meaning the world of the dead, it comes and finds at the bottom of it a reclining god. This is what this is representing. If you think of the core of the planet, of course it's a burning sun that evidently is also broadcasting energies and vibration into the surface of the planet where we normally move. And in terms of electronics, it's what we call negative and positive, and of course they go around and they connect. Time is run out, I'll just explain these two things because this is the relation that I pick around my work. This is a representation of Quetzalcoatl. It's made of a maize corn husk because Mexico is going through an endless fight with the USA, who wants to, by any means, to impose GM crops of corn. And of course, people have been fighting for not to accept that. This is the last image I have. And this is my interpretation of a Coatlicue. It's not a moving image, but the piece actually is made up of two similar pieces facing each other, and the robotic arm, when it moves, it makes the chair go out of center, and the chair begins to spin. So the chair is not meant to spin with the motor, but rather just by changing the balance of it. At the bottom of it, you can see some stones that are actually the constellation of Orion, because it's rather complex, it's no time, but Orion is supposed to have, from the prehispanic days, a wormhole from which monsters would arrive into the air, and that's what Chichen Itza was about. Ringing alarm clock, because these heavenly spirits come to earth to feed from the human soul. And it's my belief that these non-corporeal beings are already here. And we have already made a really comfortable nest, and it's in the electronic world. Because it's hard for us to think of living things that have no organic form, no material form. But we can only see when people are working with the electric gadgets like this. Basically, we can see that the mind is being drawn into the machine. And to me, this is a CC mimic that we saw earlier on. Thank you. Just one last aspect of my work. Just very quickly, I'm also developing writing in Nahuatl. As you can see, the word Huehuecoyotl, it's actually my name, which means old man coyote. And here you can see there is like a drum, it's called a Huehue. And you have these two dots here, and this animal in blue that we don't know from the drawing whether it's a dog or a wolf or a coyote. The writing works like this. These two dots signify that this word needs to be expressed twice, because the drum is called huehue. We take the first syllable, hue, but the two dots mean that it has to be pronounced twice, so it's huehue. And when we see this animal, which is the next syllable, you see this black spot, and it's actually what epigraph is called. It takes the ambiguity of what it is, and it's there to begin the next sentence, which is a coyote. But coyote in our means whole, and therefore it's painted black, and that completes the entire sound. And then we know that we are referring to a coyote and not to a wolf or a